case presentation of orthopedic x-ray. In this picture, x-ray of wrist is shown, and the case is an 18-year-old man has fallen off his mountain bike, and he presents to emergency department with a painful right wrist, and this is his x-ray. The finding on the x-ray are: this is the fracture line to the distal pole of the scaphoid as shown in this picture. Here is the fracture line, and if we see the other bones alignment, so this is the normal. So normal alignment of the carpal bones is present with the fracture to the distal pole of the scaphoid. And we will present our finding that this is a single AP view of the left wrist of a skeletally mature patient, and the x-ray is adequately exposed with no important areas cut off. This is the transverse fracture, and it is through the distal pole of the scaphoid bone. On this x-ray, the fracture appears to be minimally displaced, and the other alignment of the carpal bones is normal, and no other fractures are visible. Although I would like to view the other x-rays of the wrist and or scaphoid. Normal alignment of the carpal and metacarpal bones is evident on the single view. The bone shows normal density, and there is no areas of lucency or sclerosis. Questions associated with the scaphoid fractures are: number one, where is the typical location for pain following scaphoid fracture? Over the ulna, over the radius, in the anatomical snuff box, over the hamate, or at the first thumb carpometacarpal joint? The correct answer is in the anatomical snuff box. And the explanation of this question is given here, that in the anatomical snuff box, the anatomical snuff box is formed by the boundaries of extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, and abductor pollicis longus. If you extend your thumb, you will see a divot created dorsally at the base of the thumb, which is the anatomical snuff box, and this is the common site for pain in scaphoid fractures. Here are the some key points in the examination of the findings for the scaphoid fracture. These are pain in the anatomical snuff box, pain over the scaphoid tubercle, and pain on the telescoping of the thumb. The scaphoid tubercle is palpable at the proximal part of the thinner eminence on the volar aspect of the wrist. If you flex your fingers, they will all point to the scaphoid tubercle. To telescope the thumb, take the thumb in your hand and provide axial pressure onto the base of the thumb, which is try to push the thumb onto the trapezium. This pressure is transmitted onto the fracture scaphoid and produces pain. Patients may present with a distal radius pain following a fall on outstretched hand. Make sure you examine for a scaphoid fracture, as this is the same mechanism of injury. If you have clinical concern, request scaphoid views as well as x-ray of the distal radius. Question is, which of these carpal bones is most frequently associated with the avascular necrosis? The answer is scaphoid. And here is its explanation, that the scaphoid has an end arterial blood supply from the dorsal branch of the radial artery, which enters the scaphoid via its distal pole. So a fracture of the scaphoid can disrupt it, this tenuous blood supply, leading to avascular necrosis. Scaphoid fractures are usually classified by their location, that is, through the distal pole, through the base, and through the proximal pole. The risk of avascular necrosis is highest in the proximal fracture due to its limited blood supply, and lowest in the distal pole fractures due to the relatively good blood supply. And here are some key points that a scaphoid fracture need to be accurately diagnosed and appropriately managed to reduce the risk of the avascular necrosis developing. And consequences of avascular necrosis at any site include loss of the normal bone architecture, pain, and arthritis. Question number 3 is, Which imaging modality is least useful for diagnosing a fracture of the scaphoid? And the answer is PET scan, because this is the use in the patients with the cancer development. So all these modalities are used in one way or other way in the diagnosis of the scaphoid fracture. Scaphoid series of x-rays are the first line imaging modality for potential scaphoid fractures. However, they cannot exclude a fracture, and if there is clinical suspicion, then further imaging options such as MRI, bone scanning or CT may be required. Alternatively, the patient can be treated as scaphoid fracture and undergo follow-up x-rays 14 days after the injury to try to confirm a fracture. Question number 4 is, which of these is best management for this fracture? That is 6 weeks in a scaphoid cast with repeat x-rays at 6 weeks out of plaster. Its further explanation is, this a confirmed fracture of the scaphoid is treated with plaster immobilization for at least 6 weeks with repeated x-rays at 6 weeks to check for the x-ray signs of union. The scaphoid plaster is a plaster extending from the forearm past the thumb up to the level of metacarpophalangeal joints and incorporating the thumb up to the level of the thumb interphalangeal joint. And the last question is, which of the following structures does not run through the carpal tunnel? And its correct answer is flexor carpi radialis tendon. The carpal tunnel contains 9 tendons and 1 nerve. There are 4 tendons of FDP causing flexion at the distal interphalangeal joint, 4 tendons of FTS causing flexion at the proximal interphalangeal joint, and the 1 tendon of FPL which causes the thumb flexion. Compression of the medial nerve in the tunnel causes carpal tunnel syndrome, and this is characterized by altered sensation in the median nerve distribution, that is thumb, index, middle and radial half of the ring finger, together with pain at night and weakness, often reported by the patient as dropping objects. The flexor carpi radialis tendon inserts into the base of the second metacarpal and it does not travel in the carpal tunnel. The flexor carpi radialis causes wrist flexion and abduction. So this is all about the scaphoid fracture.